Good morning, everyone, to this November the 1st. Can you believe that we are so close to the end of the year already? This morning, we celebrate Holy Communion together as those who are bound by God's love, a love that is made real through his body that is broken and through the blood that is spilt, to make sure that nothing keeps us from that love. And so before we begin, let us light the Christ candle so as to remind ourselves that in Christ we have been saved, and that in Christ's love we are called to live lives of integrity. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning because we have been invited by you to praise you, to worship you, but most of all to live like you lived, to learn how to live lives of integrity where our actions are closely modeled on our beliefs, and that what we say will be what we do, and our beliefs will mold our behavior, and our creeds will give shape to our conduct. For Lord, if we sing praises of you, say words of worship for you, and yet live in a way that does not represent that in our Mondays to Saturdays, then Lord, we have not then fully understood what your love is meant to do. And that love is meant to transform us, making us ever so holy, like your Son was holy. And so, Lord, be with us this morning as we continue to just try to follow as best as possible the example that your Son Jesus Christ set for each of us. We pray this in your wonderful, holy name. Amen. Amen. And so before we spend a moment in worship, let's first hear the scripture that comes to us from Matthew 23, verse 1 to 12. We read, "Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, 'The teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat, so you must be careful to do everything they tell you, but do not do what they do. For they do not practice what they preach. They tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Everything they do is done for people to see. They make their phylacteries wide and the tassels on their garments long. They love the place of honor at banquets and the most important seats in the synagogues. They love to be greeted with respect in the marketplace and to be called rabbi by others. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all brothers. And do not call anyone on earth father, for you have one father, and he is in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant, for those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted.'" This is the word of our Lord. Praise be to God. Let us spend a moment as we sing a song of worship to the one master, the one teacher, the one instructor.
Nothing will not fear as long as you are here.
1805, a number of Indian chiefs and warriors met in council at Buffalo Creek, New York, to hear a presentation on the Christian message by a Mr. Cram from the Boston Missionary Society. After the sermon, a response was given by Red Jacket, one of the leading chiefs. He said, "Brother, you say that there is one way to worship and serve the Great Spirit. If there is but one religion, why do you white people differ so much about it? Why not all agree, as you can all read the book? We are told that you've been preaching to the white people in this place. These people are our neighbors. We are acquainted with them. We will wait a little while and see what effect your preaching has upon them. If we find it does them good, make them honest and less disposed to cheat Indians, we will consider again what you have said." Now, what if everyone waited to see what effect our religion had on us before we decided to accept it? I wonder how many people would accept our religion based on their observing the difference it has made in our lives. Here in our scripture, Jesus essentially says to the crowd, "Listen, what the teachers of the law and the Pharisees are saying is absolutely correct. But the gap between what they say and what they do is huge. They do not live out the law of love with integrity." Like Chief Red Jacket, Jesus looked to see if their behavior matches their belief, if their walk matches their talk, if their character matches their confession. In a word, Jesus watched to see if they had integrity. And unfortunately for the teachers of the law, as well as the Pharisees, they did not. Last week, we saw how when Jesus challenged the leaders of the day to love their neighbor, to love the stranger, to love their enemy as they loved themselves, that this was the last straw that led them to want to kill Jesus. And now we know why. Because they lived lives lacking integrity. The gap between their faith and their lived lives was so huge. And when confronted with this truth, well, you know their reactions. And so we are discovering that a major hallmark of a Christian life is integrity, where our belief in the authority of Jesus' love is seen in who we are as Christians. But let us ask, what is integrity? Integrity is the high standard of living based on Jesus' holiness. Integrity comes from the word integer. A person of integrity is whole. Their lives are put together. People with integrity have nothing to hide, nothing to fear. They are made whole in God's love. Their lives are open books. They say to a watching world, "Go ahead and look. My behavior will match my beliefs. My walk will match my talk. My character will match my confession. Who I am on Sunday will be the same on Monday and every other day." But the second point is that without a doubt, Jesus is the supreme model of integrity. His life demonstrated his purity and excellent character, so much so that even his enemies could only declare in Mark 12 verse 14, "Teacher, we know you are a man of integrity." There was no basis for guilt, no evidence of fault found in Jesus, even by Pilate. In other words, his behavior matched his belief, his walk matched his talk, his character matched his confession. If the world is watching us, then we should be watching Jesus. We should follow his example. We should do as he done. And so the question is, will we walk in Jesus' footsteps? Will we ask that tough question, what would Jesus do? Will we live a life of integrity where our lives are lived as closely as possible to that of Jesus' life? But now we can ask, how does integrity look in real life? Well, I think I've got three points to make. Through Jesus' own life, it's revealed that integrity really comes to its foreground in first, tempting situations. We know that Jesus was tempted in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the wilderness, where he faced the possibility to gain power, position, privilege. But he never strayed from letting go of what he believed in. His integrity remained intact even as he was tempted with the world. What's that saying? What is the point of gaining the whole world if you lose your soul? And too many people have lost their soul, lost their integrity while trying to gain a whole world through whatever they do. The second area where integrity counts is in those areas where we don't always get what we want. Jesus says that we are to yield to authority. But let me add quickly, I'm talking about authority that is just, right, and merciful, not authority that goes against God's commandment of love. But sometimes we have to yield to authority. And yielding is not a sign of weakness. It is a sign of self-control. It is saying, I do not have to have my way all the time. Integrity says, I may not like the law, but I will obey it. Integrity says, I might not like the direction the nation is going in, but I will pray for God's intervention. God says, I will obey God first, even if it means giving up the things I want. This can be at work, at school, in society, in our own families. But integrity demands that we stand for what is right, and we must do upright things. Right here in our own church, I know people who have stood with integrity when they've been offered opportunities of corruption, but they have said no. And then the third most important area where integrity counts is in suffering. The greatest test of integrity is how we respond to suffering. You will truly know a person how they react in a time of suffering. For it's been said, Christians are like tea bags. One does not know what they are like on the inside until they are in hot water. And unfortunately, in this life, we will always experience suffering, have problems, experience pain. The question is, how will we deal with it? People are watching to see just how we react in those moments when we are suffering. Helen Keller said, although the world is full of suffering, it is also full of overcoming it. She also said that because of her blindness and deafness, she was able to see and hear God ever so more. Will you hold on to your beliefs in times of suffering, or will they go out of the window? You see, here is the hard truth with the teachers and the law of the law and the Pharisees failed. You see, our integrity will be put to test every day in virtually every situation. We are being watched closely to how we will respond. And the choice of our walk matching our talk, our behavior matching our beliefs, our character matching our confessions is left to us. What will we do? But I hope that you do know this. When we live lives of integrity, integrity itself is an amazing gift which will always bring you closer to Jesus. When your life is lived with your belief and your behavior lived closely, when your life is lived with your conduct and your confession lived closely, when your life is lived that what you see in Jesus, others see in you, in that moment know that life, that integrity brings you close to Jesus. And so may you live ever so closer and closer to Jesus Christ as you gain a life that is full of integrity. But most of all, we see this gift of integrity right here at the Holy Table, where Jesus' belief in a love that cannot be destroyed, in a love that can change the world, in a love that it can offer salvation and restoration, a love that can create new life. From that belief, Jesus then lived out his life that then led him to the cross. In the belief that his blood can bring forgiveness, that his blood can reconcile humanity and creation to the Creator and the Father. In his belief that his blood can remove all obstacles to, all obstacles that prevent us from experiencing the love of God. He then lived his life and was willing to die for what he believed in. The truth is, the holy table, this blessed meal, is a meal of integrity. A meal where we know that Jesus, he lived every single belief he had. He died because of every single confession he had made. And so when you come to this table, it's an invitation to now live your life as someone who will live a life of integrity, willing to give everything for life, willing to die for divine life. Let us pray. Father, we come to this table because it truly is a table of integrity. Integrity that your Son showed us is capable of deep transformation, not just in individuals, but in communities, in countries, in all of creation. And so, Lord, as we come to receive the body of your Son, as we come to receive the blood of your Son, may we be filled with that same sense of wanting, of desiring, of needing to live our lives with integrity. For, Lord, we know that there are just too many politicians, ministers, doctors, nurses, lawyers, mechanics, plumbers, teachers, you name it, Lord, who are not living lives of integrity, and we know the damage that they do in this world, in the lives of individuals. And so, Lord, let this be a meal that places a divine DNA in each of us so that we can't live any other way but a life filled with integrity. For we know through your Son Jesus Christ what integrity is able to do. It is able to bring light into darkness. It is able to have life conquer death. It is able to bring healing to what is hurt and to bring restoration to what has been broken. Thank you, Lord. And so, my friends, let us celebrate this meal on the night on which our Lord Jesus Christ was to be betrayed by those who had no integrity. He gathered with his friends, and he took the bread, and he gave thanks, and he blessed it. And then he broke it. Saying to them, "This is my body broken for you. Whenever you take and eat it, do this in remembrance of me, and in remembrance of knowing that God's love will never forsake you, will never leave you. For God's love and God's actions can never be separated. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks and he blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my cup, this is my blood poured out for you and for many in a new covenant for the forgiveness of sins. I do this so that nothing can separate you from the Father's love. I do this so that you may be whole, as you are able to then fully live in the wholeness of your Father. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me." And so, Heavenly Father, we come to this table not because of any goodness of our own, but purely because of the life you live. Purely because of the grace you give, purely because of the wholeness of your life that cause us to be whole with you. And so, my friends, I invite you to pick up your bread, to break it, and to share it among yourselves, saying, "This is the body of Christ broken for you because of how much he loves you." Now we take the cup and we share it amongst each other as we say, "This is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, spilt for you for the forgiveness of your sins." Lord, we give thanks for this sacred holy meal that makes us whole, that makes us whole through your love and grace and mercy, that makes the world whole through justice and righteousness. Lord, we receive these gifts with thankful, grateful hearts. Hear us now, Lord, as we share this prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, just as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And so, as challenging as it may be, as tempting as it may be to give up on the beliefs and the confessions that Jesus has called us to embrace, to hold on to with every part of our mind, body, heart, and soul, we must never let go of the things that will bring us closer to God by teaching us how to live lives of integrity. May your word be your bond. May your actions confess your belief in God's love. May your choices tell the world that indeed you are a Christ follower. And so let us embrace God's hands or one another's hands as we say together, and now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, go in love, and go and live lives of integrity.